You may remember hearing earlier this year that Olivia Newton-John was close to death. Well, after spending a few days with the superstar at her ranch in California, I'm pleased to say the rumours of her imminent demise were way off the mark. Yes, she's battling stage 4 cancer. Yes, there are bad days as well as good ones. But what I found was a woman of awe-inspiring positivity, strength and courage. Tonight, our Olivia as you've never heard her before. Plus, a rare and raw insight from her daughter, Chloe. How the devotion of a loving family and an unconventional treatment are helping her face up to the greatest challenge of her life.
Hey.
I said a nightmare.
Olivia Newton-John has spent most of her life taking centre stage.
It is a very significant moment. It is a rare occasion. Here we are in Los Angeles paying tribute to someone who is truly a great ambassador for our nation.
But today, it's different.
Your Excellency, I present to you Olivia Newton-John, AO OBE, who has been awarded as a companion in the General Division of the Order of Australia.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Australia's sweetheart is receiving the nation's highest honour.
You are the most optimistic, hopeful person I have ever met.
But for this consummate professional, the occasion proves almost too much.
I'll continue to do my best for a country I love very much. And I've always felt it was my home, even though I live here. I'm going to cry now. Thank you.
With her husband John and daughter Chloe by her side, as well as a small gathering of her closest friends, Olivia knows all too well these are precious moments.
The tears falling away.
It's a very big honour. It's lovely.
Do you think about that?
When you ask me, I do. I don't think about it generally, but I don't feel I've done anything more than anyone else would have done in my position, and probably could have done more, but doing what I can.
Olivia Newton-John has always been one of us, inspiring even as she fights the darkest of diseases. Olivia has stage 4 cancer. It's her third bout, and by far the toughest.
I'm so lucky that I've been through this 3 times and I'm still here. I'm living with it. So it just reinforced my gratitude because, you know, we know we're going to die at some point. Unfortunately, being humans, we have that knowledge.
Yeah, it's a bugger, isn't it?
And we don't know when it is. When you're given a cancer diagnosis or a scary illness diagnosis, you're suddenly given a possibility of a time limit. The truth is, you get hit by a truck tomorrow, you know, you don't know. So every day is a gift now, you know, particularly now.
Olivia is a 4-times Grammy winner who's sold more than 100 million records.
If not for you. See me wide away.
She was barely 23 when she cracked the UK market.
You have to believe we are magic. Nothing can stand in our way.
And it was not long after that that America too fell in love with her. But Olivia's incredible career was interrupted when she was diagnosed with breast cancer 27 years ago. She beat it, but it reappeared in 2013. And then in May 2017, she was told the cancer had metastasized and spread to her bones.
steals my lips.
No one's ever given you a time. Time's up in whenever? No one said that to you?
No, but if you started reading statistics on what you have, you could get into that. I don't. I don't read statistics.
How did you avoid that? One part of me would want to know, but the other part would be, I don't really want to know.
Well, it's if you believe it, you see. If you believe the statistics, you're going to make them happen. If somebody tells you you have 6 months to live, very possibly you will because you believe that. So for me, psychologically, it's better not to have any ideas of what they expect or what the last person that had what you have lived. So I don't tune in. It's just better for me.
How do you look at death?
A long way away.
Her bodily functions appear to be shutting down.
It didn't seem so long back in January.
The National Enquirer's front page story claims the end is near.
Reports of Olivia being at death's door began circulating gossip and news sites and quickly gained momentum.
Did that piss you off?
It was weird feeling. I mean, to read that you're dead is or you're dying is a very strange experience.
The rumours of my death have been greatly exaggerated, to quote a very famous quote.
And then I decided, well, I've just got to see an end to this because it's going to develop into, you know, the front page of all the tabloids and stuff.
Where did that come from?
I have no idea. I thought I'd just confront it rather than let this... because it was upsetting. It was a really strange feeling. And then you think, maybe they know something I don't.
Coming up, a daughter's courage.
I didn't realise that would be hard.
A rare moment with a very raw Chloe.
Because we don't talk about it.
That's right.
As she opens up on her toughest days.
Can I give you a hug?
Really? Absolutely. Happy to give you a hug.
That's next on 60 Minutes. Olivia's daughter, 33-year-old Chloe Lattanzi, is taking time to be with her mother and making the most of every moment. It's living, not dying, that's the focus of each day.
We don't talk about it.
You don't need to talk about
it? We don't need to talk about it. If she's having a day where she needs to talk about it, I'm there to listen and to always reassure. I'll never bring it up unless she wants to. Do you know what I mean?
Coming to understand cancer is something Chloe has had to do since she was a child. When she first learned of her mother's illness from another pupil while attending school in Australia.
That obviously profoundly affected you at that time.
I was upset with her because I wanted to take care of her. I said, why didn't you tell me? I could have taken care of you, you know? I felt like my mom's protector, I think.
What difference would it have made to you, do you think, if you'd known?
I developed a fear of sudden illnesses, right? I think that maybe not talking about it made it more powerful because it created a much bigger monster than it really was. And I think getting into it, explaining it to me, maybe would have given me more of a sense of control. I feel for my mom, though, because God, like, she... imagine having to tell your daughter that she, like, didn't want me to have to stress.
Chloe is the much-loved child Olivia and her former husband, actor and dancer Matt Lattanzi, desperately wanted. Little Chloe watched her mother endure and then courageously defeat her cancer.
1 in 8 women are faced with breast cancer, and I'm one of the lucky ones that are still here 5.5 years later. Yes, I'm very lucky.
You learn about it as a little girl, it goes away, but then it comes back again.
Yeah. I was in shock, angry, denial. And I've always seen my mom just overcome, but I would wake up, you know, in night sweats and panic attacks, and I kind of pushed it. I didn't deal with it.
And then we hear about it. It's a third time.
I didn't really like that everyone knew. It annoyed me.
And why?
It's a really private, painful, draining... I just felt protective, and I didn't like these strangers giving me advice or telling me what my mom should or shouldn't. Like, I was just pissed. I was mad because if anyone doesn't deserve to go through cancer, it's my mom. I feel like my mom and my family needed to be protected, and even though you can, like, hide from people, you still feel that energy, and I didn't want them to write stories and make her be reminded that she's sick or say things, you know, like she's looking sick, and I didn't want anyone to instill any kind of fear in her. Do you know what I mean?
I do, because I guess when we're talking about fear, we're talking about loss.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that?
I have days where I don't deal with it, and I'm in denial, and I don't think about it.
I've seen a huge change and growth in her. She's just the most beautiful being and has a huge heart and great compassion and understanding. Yeah.
She says it's still difficult to talk with you about your cancer and not get scared.
Mm-hmm. I understand that. We don't talk about it very much. Chloe's been to a couple of doctor's appointments with me, and she sees that I just want to get on with it. And if sometimes we'll talk about it a little, but it's not something that we talk about a lot. And that's fine. She understands. She has a same kind of instincts that I do.
Is it harder to talk to her about it perhaps than it is to us?
Yes, I think so. Yeah.
Because she's so
close. She's my
close.
Daughter, you know, she's part of me, and I know that she gets affected, but she's very strong and she doesn't really show me that.
Mm.
Can I give you a hug?
Please, absolutely. Happy to give you a hug. I hand that.
But as strong as Chloe tries to be, it's clear she's still very fragile.
I didn't realise that would be hard.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
It's hard sometimes, isn't it, to chat about the person you love most?
Because we don't talk about it.
That's right.
It's no secret she's had her own challenges. A well-documented drug and alcohol addiction and battle with anorexia.
We all have our cancers. You know, mine is my battle with addiction. I'll have that, you know, I have to keep myself sober the rest of my life. And that's a fight, and it takes work. And we all have our cancers. And I think it sort of helps to... I'm not trying to make her struggle sound small. I'm trying to say, like, I think it makes it easier to deal with when you go, oh, yeah, everyone has a cancer.
So how do you think your mum's journey with cancer has changed you?
Oh, wow. How has it changed me? Her journey, it definitely, her illness helped me heal my illness. I mean, it's some pretty deep, I don't know how far to go into it. I knew I needed to be, I wanted to be bright and happy and available and around for my mom when she was struggling with this. And I thought I was okay, but I wasn't. I was still struggling with, you know, severe depression and whatever. And I faced it head on.
It sounds to me like you felt you had to be your best.
Yeah.
For your mom.
Yeah. It's like, it was kind of like, oh, can't run anymore. It's like, this is a really finite, black and white thing you're looking at, kind of, and there's no more sort of running away anymore from your pain. Deal with it. She needs you, you know? And I feel like I've just become a much better person.
Coming up, a secret admission to her own hospital.
No one knew who it was. She snuck around with a beanie on and with a face mask on.
She's a gladiator.
She's a real fighter. She's a trooper.
And the best wardrobe clear out ever. And they are iconic. Look at that. This is quite the throw out.
Yeah.
That's next on 60 Minutes. Olivia Newton-John had been free of her breast cancer for nearly 21 years when it suddenly returned in 2013. She kept it a secret and thought she'd dealt with it. But then, in 2017, it came back.
Yeah, the first time I knew something was up. And the last two times, I think the second time, there's probably a little bit of denial each time because I don't want it to be true, but I would always look into it. And the last one with the sacrum, that was probably the scariest because it's affecting my bones. But I'm getting strong again, so I'm good.
Here we go. Three, two, one.
Last year, Olivia was in Australia supporting her annual walk, raising funds for the Olivia Newton-John Wellness and Cancer Centre in Melbourne when she was admitted to her own hospital with a broken sacrum. Olivia was in agony and at times could barely move. And life is our living
proof. I had just finished the walk. I was just about to film with Paul Hogan and I was in horrible pain and ended up being in there secretly as undercover boss for 3 weeks.
No one knew who it was. She snuck around with a beanie on and with a face mask on so that people couldn't see who it was.
She's a gladiator, isn't she?
She's a real fighter. She's a trooper.
Professor Jonathan Seebon is the head of the Olivia Newton-John Research Institute and understands all too well what Olivia is up against.
And have the wellness programs been helping?
We measure cancer in stages, is that right?
That's right.
Olivia Newton-John is stage 4.
Right.
There's no stage 5.
No.
Olivia believes that she will win. Knowing what you know about Olivia and her cancer, can she win?
So I think the question is, what is winning? So if winning is to remain strong and to face the challenges and to not allow the disease to defeat your spirit, then she's winning. In terms of the biological effects of the disease that's in her bones, that requires medical treatment, and she's using everything she's got to control the disease, and she's got it under control for now. So, you know, with the help of her doctors, I think things are going very well. In the long term, stage 4 breast cancer, is not something that we see as a curable disease.
If that prognosis can change, it just might happen here.
So we pair up our clinical teams with our laboratory teams to translate scientific discoveries into clinical benefit.
Clinicians and scientists have been working together at the Olivia Newton-John Institute, desperately searching for an answer. Researchers here have so far embarked on 200 clinical trials. Professor Seebon's special interest is in immunobiology.
How far away is the eureka, do you think?
Well, I think the eureka is creeping up on us. Across the spectrum, there are incremental steps. So I don't think there's going to be a day when we open the paper and find that suddenly cancer's been cured. What we'll find is that for different types of cancer, better treatments become available, and little by little we get towards a point where fewer and fewer people suffer from the disease.
If it wasn't for him, I don't know what would have happened.
But until then, it means those suffering cancers like Olivia's remain extremely vulnerable.
Like, no, I'll get there. I'm strong. I like you.
And Olivia admits that while in hospital, she was very concerned.
Did you ever think you might not walk again?
I had moments where I was concerned I may not walk again. I had one leg that was pretty wonky for a while. But I was determined that I would. So, you know, I started out in a wheelchair and then a walker and then a cane, and now I'm back to full force again.
Is this word cancer starting to become a bit of a demon? Or
no.
Do you not let that happen?
No, I don't let it become that. It's something I'm living with and I don't see it that way. It's a choice. Everything's a choice. So I see it as something in my body that I'm getting rid of. I don't talk about a battle or a war because I think that sets up that kind of feeling in your body of you're battling something strange inside you. I let it go and tell it to leave and talk to my body to heal itself and don't try to make it that, you know, because that takes up your whole life and your whole being. I kind of have a way, I think, of disassociating and compartmentalizing it. Otherwise, you become a victim, which I don't want to be and I'm not, or you become a slave to it and talk about it all the time, which I try not to do either.
Do you say those things, like, time to go?
Yes, I do. In my meditations, I visualize it leaving and I see the herbs and the medicines that I'm taking. Making it go, yes.
Coming up...
The pain was intense.
Months and months of crying out loud pain. It was so bad.
It was so bad.
From morphine to more weed. The unconventional treatment with astonishing results.
How hard was it to get Olivia across to the idea? Because I think there was a bit of resistance based on, you know, it's had a bad rep.
And the Grease wardrobe numbers up for grabs.
You've had a sneaky try on of these.
I did, actually. I was kind of dared into trying them on.
And that's next on 60 Minutes.
In his greenhouse out the back of their sprawling Santa Barbara ranch in California, John Easterling, Olivia Newton-John's husband of 10 years, tends to his plants. He has become Olivia's alternate medicine man. When you cry for me. And these plants, he believes, could well hold the key to his wife's recovery. His miracle medicine is cannabis.
How hard was it to get Olivia across to the idea? Because I think there was a bit of resistance based on, you know, it's had a bad rep. It's, you know, marijuana is something that we equate to a drug culture.
Yeah, exactly. And she was never involved in the drug culture, which is really fascinating for someone of her stature in the music business. But she remembered smoking one time, you know, in the 70s and said, I don't want to do that again, and didn't. You know?
She was a bit nervous. Were you a bit nervous? About that first time?
I was highly confident up front, but deep inside, yeah, I was a bit nervous that, oh no, you know, how is this going to work?
This is a national treasure here.
John has long held a strong belief in the medicinal power of plants, having spent years cultivating herbs from the Amazon. Olivia's health is being maintained by a combination of conventional and herbal remedies. But cannabis is what he's hoping will keep Olivia alive, healthy, and importantly, pain-free.
So Olivia pretty quickly got a good result.
Yeah, very quickly, yeah. Like, I mean, very quickly.
Like
20 minutes.
20 minutes?
Yeah, it's not like do it for 30 days and see what happens. It's like you know, like right away, yeah.
When I broke my sacrum, I was on morphine because the pain was intense. I was terrified of starting it because I know it's a very hard thing to wean off. But I am now off it, yes, and I weaned myself off it with cannabis.
You described your pain as months and months of excruciating, sleep-depriving, crying out loud pain.
Mm-hmm.
It was so bad.
It was so bad.
And if you weren't taking that cannabis?
I'd be in pain. Yes.
Did you have to talk with your doctors about it before starting it?
I told them I was going to do it, and they were actually very positive about it. They were happy for me to do it.
No one was worried? No one said that maybe, you know, we don't... I presume you know your dosage? I presume you don't?
No. Dosage is different with cannabis. You learn how, you know, one drop or two drops is enough. You learn by the feel. It's like anything. Like if you drink alcohol, you'll learn one glass is enough for you, maybe two for somebody else. But if I don't take the drops, I can feel the pain, so I know it's working. So I do that sometimes. I stop just to see what happens. So I'm incredibly pro-cannabis.
It also helps you with anxiety?
Yes.
Sleep?
Yes. Yes.
Medicinal cannabis is widely used to treat cancer symptoms, particularly in California where it's legal. But John Easterling believes this is a plant that could potentially provide those suffering with cancer with much more. And he believes he's already seen physical evidence in Olivia's treatment.
And do you think you can cure Olivia's cancer?
I don't use the word cure. I mean, people exhibit certain symptomology and then they're in a hurry to find somebody to give it a name. Cannabis can be used for so many things.
You say you don't like the word cure, mm-hmm. but have you seen differences in tumors?
Yeah, I'm confident. Yeah, we had the latest MRIs is showing a lesser number of tumors, and the majority of the other ones are shrinking.
That's huge.
It's huge.
When you see how do you feel when you see that?
Oh, I'm thrilled, you know. I'm thrilled, I'm blessed, I'm excited, and I'm just over the moon. You know, I can't say it's all cannabis because we do have a variety of Amazonian botanicals there too. And then she's doing an estrogen blocker.
And there's no toxicity that you're concerned about? There's no downside that you're aware of?
I haven't seen toxicity or downside. Even as with all the plants I've worked with, the toxicity level on cannabis, I mean, no one's ever died. So there's an extraordinary gift here, and the mobility's increasing, her energy level's increasing, and we were concerned that she couldn't walk from the house down to feed the horses. And so that was where the conversation was at one point. And now she's down there brushing the horses and feeding the horses and driving off and shopping and visiting friends. And just, it's astonishing, really.
Friday, 22nd of June.
Mike, Dr. Dandy.
Hi. It was a really shit day.
Olivia and John are now cannabis converts. They feature in a new Australian documentary, High as Mike.
I was diagnosed with a brain tumour.
Brain cancer sufferer Mike Gallagher explores medicinal cannabis as an alternative treatment. In his documentary, he talks with Olivia, and she doesn't hold back.
I can't advise you to break the law, but, you know, I know what I would do.
Was that a leap of some kind for Olivia Newton-John to do that?
Probably, yes.
That?
It just came out and I went, oh, blimey. But, you know, yes, I think if you're in horrible pain and you don't want to take drugs, a lot of people have problems with drugs. Cannabis is a safe alternative and it helps.
Olivia and John are now campaigning for medicinal cannabis to be legalised so that Australians can have greater access to the plant.
So is there a resistance, do you think, because it is a drug?
It's not a drug, you see, that's the problem. It's not a drug, and that's a name that is thrown around with cannabis, but it's not a drug, it's a herb and a plant. And I think when people use the word drug, it's a misconception as to what it is, and it gets people thinking, oh, it's just another drug, but it's not. It's not just another drug. It's a plant, and there are lots of different strains, and over the last 30 years or so, they've improved them so much that now you can have one drop or one toke and it'll help you with your anxiety or with, you know, it's a very different world.
Olivia Newton-John's having a toke.
Oh, toke. Oh, yeah.
So Olivia Newton-John tells me she has a toke in the morning.
Right.
You know what that means?
Medicinal marijuana.
And what do you think about that?
Look, there's absolutely no doubt that a lot of patients with, you know, with cancer use medicinal marijuana and report great benefits from it. So you have to believe what the patients tell you.
At the Olivia Newton-John Research Institute, head oncologist Professor Jonathan Seaborn and his team are open to the idea and want to explore the benefits of cannabis in the lab. It's a tricky area, I understand, because as a doctor, you want to have scientific evidence.
Right.
But you're seeking to do that.
We can do clinical trials, and we're very happy to be able to do a clinical trial with medicinal cannabis to assess its effects on the quality of life with patients with cancer.
And that's the plan.
So we have a trial currently in the pipeline. It's not quite ready for prime time yet, but it'll be opening later this year.
Like all research, it takes money to keep scientists on the trail of a breakthrough. But Olivia's hospital coffers are about to get a kick in the pants, but in a good way. Olivia Newton-John is clearing out the closet and letting go of some of her most prized possessions. And up for auction are those impossibly tight trousers she wore in the hit film Grease. Get a load of these. Get these. A load of those.
These were from the 50s. They're shark skin, I think it's called, the fabric. And when we tried these on, right, they have this belt that's attached to it around the front. But the zip was broken, and so they, you can see where it's kind of screwy, and they didn't want to do anything to it in case it ruined them. So they left it broken and they stitched me in. I better shape up, cause you need a man.
I need a man who can keep me satisfied. But you've had a sneaky try on of these.
I did, actually. About a year ago, we were taking a picture of the jacket and I was kind of dared into trying them on.
And
I got them on, amazingly.
Surprised me.
Very surprising.
No. They're fantastic.
Yeah.
And they are iconic, aren't they?
Yeah, they are, and I hope somebody really wants them and wants to pay a lot of money for them so that the hospital can benefit.
Well, this is quite the throw out.
Yeah.
But there's more. The leather jacket Olivia teamed with those tight trousers.
Tell me about it, Stir.
That's the Grease jacket.
That is the Grease jacket that I wore in the finale. Cause the power you're supplying,
it's electrifying. Do you wear
intact.
It? Ever?
Oh, I never wear it.
And if that's not enough,
wait,
and these,
wait,
these are
steak
cool.
Knives.
These are really cool. These are back in fashion, like this year.
Look at those.
Look at these.
Olivia is giving up those thigh-high boots she wore in the film Xanadu.
Look at that.
I'm amazed I kept them. We found a whole bunch of stuff in storage. And this was one of them.
They are all back. Isn't that amazing how all this stuff comes back?
I know.
It is a very generous offering. But Olivia wants to raise as many dollars as she can. We'll always be like one.
Wow, 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 wow. There's no part of you that's going,
No. I've worn them. They've given me an incredible career and now I kiss them goodbye and their value hopefully can help a lot of people going through cancer, so it's an easy choice.
It wasn't hard at all, huh?
No.
How much am I looking at here?
Well, I'm hoping to get $1 million apiece for the jacket and pants. That's my what I'm putting out there.
At least.
At least.
Don't you reckon that's where they should start?
Yeah, I reckon they should, but, you know. Yeah, I saw, what did I see online the other day? There was something like a hockey stick from some famous Stanley Cup or something that was like $1 million. I'm thinking, are you kidding me? I'll sell my jacket and pants.
I'll raise you.
Right.
How long have you been looking at those? I mean, you've had those.
I don't look at them.
You just,
I keep them
just
hidden.
Away.
I keep them hidden away.
Oh, hidden.
Out of the light, you know. But
so are they
I look at them
lock
occasionally.
And key?
Oh, yeah, I have a guide dog back there and chains and.
Is that the one that was licking me when I was high?
That's the one.
Coming up, a mother and daughter united.
She's amazing to me because she's Liv, my mom, not because she's Olivia Newton-John. I couldn't care less.
As they take Olivia's next step together.
I'm walking around better now, so you never know.
Yeah, look at that, show off.
That's next on 60 Minutes.
I like the grass between my toes.
Doesn't that feel good?
Olivia Newton-John is decluttering and downsizing, getting rid of what she calls stuff. And that includes her properties as well as possessions. But Olivia is currently in a sweet spot. In the last few months, she's been feeling less tired and physically stronger. Her home in the hills of Santa Barbara, California, is on the market. But now, she's not so sure.
This is beautiful.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
I'm not sure that you should leave this.
I'm not sure I should either.
I can, you know, I can officially take it off the market right now.
I'm walking around better now, so you never know.
Yeah, you're walking well. I'm pleased to see you. Yeah, look at that, show off.
She has a spring in her step and a discerning environmentalist eye on the future.
That planet's in flux. It's trying to decide what it wants to do. The planet will go on. I mean, she'll regenerate, but...
We won't.
We won't.
We will evolve, you think?
Evolve, maybe.
What will we evolve into?
I don't know. That's an interesting thought. But survival of the fittest will probably happen.
Hi, guys. Hi, Weenie.
Olivia is happy at home, chatting to her horses.
Weenie. Come give me kisses. Come on. I love you. Thank you.
And painting while soaking up the afternoon sun.
Aussie salute.
For the first time in her life, she's not having to perform. Instead, taking time for herself.
But I was stopped, and maybe that was my big lesson. Like, my body stopped me in my tracks and said, okay, you can't move. Now you're going to have to look at everything and decide what you want to do. And I'm loving being at home and helping, supporting John and what he's doing. And I have things going on, but not live performances. So it's really lovely time. I'm getting to watch daytime television.
How's that going?
And catch up on series. It's great.
More than 2 years on, Olivia's husband John and her daughter Chloe admit they're still coming to terms with this third cancer diagnosis. But their focus is on keeping Olivia well by giving her all the support she needs.
She's just a normal person and she's amazing to me because of her heart. She's amazing to me because of her sense of humor and her wit. She's amazing to me because she's Liv, my mom, not because she's Olivia Newton-John. I couldn't care less. And I think that's really important for my mom to know because with this illness, she hasn't been able to perform. And I think that she's gotten that love from a lot of strangers. And I think that in not being able to get that for a while, there is a fear that comes up. And I think, I hope, you know, I told her, as mom, you're enough. You, just you. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to perform for anyone. You are so beautiful and vibrant just sitting there. And I just want to see her be okay to just relax and be with her dog and be with me. And she's just whole and perfect as her. Doesn't need a name.
Weenie!
Olivia's leaving.
Bye!
Oh, he said bye. Bye, honey.
Olivia Newton-John believes she can stare down her cancer. But it's not going to be easy. What sustains her is the embrace of a loving family and an extraordinary resilience. Olivia Newton-John is one tough woman.
Anything about yourself that you didn't know?
Maybe that I was as strong as I was, that I didn't know that. But I think anyone who's challenged with something like this, I think you find resources you didn't know you had because you didn't have to.
Have there been instances where you've recognised your strength?
I think many times. But I think I don't think about myself and go, oh, you're being strong. You just live your life and you do what you have to do to get through. And just when you're looking back, you go, gosh, that was pretty gnarly what I went through there. But it's not like I'm conscious of it. But I think that many people I know who have been through difficulty find this incredible strength because you have to. No one can do it for you. It's just you, you know.
This is new.
I'm sure you'll agree, Olivia Newton-John is one extraordinary woman. We wish her all the very best. And if you'd like to join Olivia in this year's Wellness Walk to raise money for cancer research, details are on our website. Hello, I'm Liz Hayes. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9 Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.